الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين وعلى من تبع هداهم إلى يوم الدين. After praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and passing salutation upon His Messenger Muhammad, may peace and blessings be upon him, we go ahead with our book. First we start with Al-Adab al-Mufrad, Al-Imam Abi Abdullah Muhammad ibn Ismail al-Bukhari رحمه الله. So he says in his book Al-Adab al-Mufrad, chapter 124, باب الانبساط إلى الناس, cheerfulness towards people. قال عن عطاء بن يسار رضي الله عنه. On the authority, usually it's the case we have a brother to read, but I'm going to read inshallah myself. I'm going to translation and I'll translate as well as much as I can. He says that Ata, he said, I have met Abdullah ibn Amr ibn As. And I said to him, describe for me the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam according to the Torah. And the Torah is the book of the Jews. So he said, yes. And then he said, by Allah, he is described in the Torah partly as, he says, يَا أَيُّهَا النَّبِيِّ إِنَّا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ شَاهِدًا وَمُبَشِّرًا وَنَذِيرًا. O Prophet, we have sent you as a witness, a bearer of good news, and a warner and a protection to the unlettered. And this is, by the way, in Surah Al-Ahzab, verse 45. وَحِرْزًا لِلْأُمِّيِّينَ. And also a protection to the unlettered. أنت عبدي ورسولي. You are my slave and you are my messenger. سميتك المتوكل. I have called you the trusty. المتوكل. The one who you rely upon. ليس بفظ ولا غليظ. Is neither coarse nor harsh. ولا صخاب في الأسواق. Nor loud in the markets. ولا يفع بالسيئة السيئة. And he does not push away the evil with evil. ولكن يعفو ويغفر. But he forgives and tolerates. ولا يقبضه الله تعالى. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not pass death upon him. حتى يقيم به الملة العوجاء. Until he has made the crooked community straight by him. قال بأن يقولوا, so that they say لا إله إلا الله, there is no God worthy of worship except for Allah. قال ويفتحوا بها أعينا عميا, and by it they will open blind eyes. وآذانا صما, and he will as well open the deaf ears. وَقُلُوبًا غُلْفًا, and he always will open the covered hearts, or he will uncover the covered hearts. This narration from Ata ibn Yasar, who is from the followers, who had met a great companion called Abdullah ibn Amr ibn As, who is known for his ibadah, and also, according to some of the scholars, that he used to look into the Torah. Torah, which is a book that belongs to the Jews, and which is the one that supposed to be, that is, received by Musa alayhi salam, but the Jews had added to it, and they've taken as well a statement from it. The Torah, also like the Injil which is the gospel that was sent to Isa alayhi salam, also was tampered with by the people of the book, by the Christians. Hey, Abdullah ibn Amr ibn As, he was known to look into that book and read. And you might ask why he's reading the book. For verily, we know that the Prophet ﷺ, he saw that Umar al-Khattab one day holding a piece of Torah in his hand, he was enraged and he was angry. He said to Umar, verily, if Musa alayhi salam was alive, then he would not do anything except that he would follow me. So that means you don't need to read in the Torah. Well, we have to make an arbitration in order to understand both of the statements here. First of all, this is Abdullah ibn Amr ibn As. It's not the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And it is, that is, a fact that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he had told Umar al-Khattab radiallahu anhu not, we told him off, not to read from the Torah because of many issues. Number one, the companions at that time, their religion is still fresh in their hearts, meaning that they are not far away from the disbelief. And when the person is not far away from the disbelief, and his iman is not firmed, he is not advised to go read in something that we might put doubts in his heart. That is why the Prophet ﷺ forbade the companions to go and visit the graves at the beginning, because the grave was linked to rituals that they used to do before they embraced Islam. And once the iman was in the heart, then the Prophet ﷺ, he said, "Verily, I prohibited you from visiting the grave, but now visit the graves," because the iman is in the heart stronger than it was at the beginning. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam also, he told Mu'adh ibn Jabal radiallahu anhu wa arda, when he was at the back of him on a donkey called Ufir, and he said to him, "O Mu'adh, do you know the rights or the due rights of Allah on his slaves and the due rights of the slaves of Allah on Allah?" He said, "Allah is Muslim, he knows best." He said, "Verily, the due rights of Allah on his slaves, that if they worship him alone, associating nothing in his worship, then he will make the rights of the due rights of Allah on his slaves, that is to worship him alone and associate nothing in his worship. And the due rights of the people on Allah, that if they do so, then Allah will not put them in the hellfire." So Mu'adh ibn Jabal, he said, "O Prophet of Allah, shall I inform the people?" He said, "No, Allah yattaqi, and they might rely upon this, and they will not do any good deeds. They will just say, we'll say La ilaha illallah, and we don't need to have to do any good deeds." Mu'adh ibn Jabal, he had told this just before he died. Tahannutha, that means to come out of the sin, because in case he keeps the knowledge and he does not convey it. So he told it just about when he died. So we still could see here that there is two different phases. Phase number one, the companions at the beginning. Phase number two, the companions at the end. And definitely the iman increases and it decreases. And the more they were with the Prophet of Allah, the iman was going up. And that is why we say to the person, is not fit to tell the person from the first go, if he embraces Islam, everything, because he might put him off. So to gradually tell him, and he has to learn, just like the companions when they entered the Islam, they entered to Islam gradually, like the prohibition of wine. It was not done one go, it was gradually. So the gradual sort of process in the da'wah is very important. So Abdullah ibn Amr ibn As, he's been asked by Atta ibn Yasar well after the death of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So it's already the iman in his heart. But does that mean we need to read in the scripture of the people of the book? Well, if the person is, for example, specified himself into debating with the people of the book, and he himself want to understand how to give the da'wah in a better way and more presentable, and also to tell the people of the book that even your book, it tells you about the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we would say that it would be advisable to read what the Muslims had said about the people of the book and their quotation. Instead of you going to look into the book, you depend upon a Muslim who already done it for you, and he's giving you the quotation that you need to use in order to propagate your da'wah. Do you understand that? I don't need to read myself, and I will read from those. If I find that there is more to be dug, then I need to make sure that I am well equipped with the iman and that I have been with intensive knowledge, and makes me firm, not with a shaky belief, that if I read something, it might, makes me sort of not sure about what I'm believing. So it is very important that before I go ahead and swim in such an ocean, I need to make sure that I'm able to swim, otherwise I might drown. And if I drown, God knows where you're going to end up. Are you going to become, stay the same, or are you going to be not the same? My dear boys, please sit down. My dear boys, I beg you. Please. No. Don't sit down together. Sit down here, please. Come here. Come here, please. Stand up. Come here. Stand up, my dear boys. Here. Okay, sit down. Stay put. Zagat. Right. Now, so we say Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As is a person who is well into the ibadah, well into the knowledge. He's a knowledgeable and he is a worshipper as well. So he's reading in the book of the Torah, and Atta ibn Isar, he knows that Abdullah ibn Amr is a specified person, into this. So he wanted to know, for the sake of curiosity, did you read any description of the Prophet of Allah in the Torah that you've been reading? Did you have a description of the Prophet of Allah? Because they, Christian, they believe and they claim that the Prophet of Allah is not there. But did you have the Prophet of Allah there? What is the description of the Torah? The Jews, they claim that they, and the Christians as well, that the Prophet of Allah is not in their book. So he says, yes, he's there. And he's been described in the Torah with some of his description in the Quran. Not all the description, but some of his description in the Quran. So he says that verily the verse, which is Surah Al-Ahzab, Ya ayyuha an-nabi, inna arsalnaka shahida wa mubashshira wa nadhira, it is there. I could find that. That is, O Prophet, we have sent you as a witness. A witness that Allah is one. Also, a witness on the day of resurrection regarding the people. So this is a witness, means that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will also witness, like his ummah is a witness, that those messengers had conveyed their message. A witness that the messengers had conveyed their message to the people. A witness as well on his ummah, on this ummah, that he had conveyed the message. So he's a witness. Wa mubashshira, and a glad tidings. Giving glad tidings, that is to the believers, that they will be rewarded. And wa nadhira, and a warner for those disbelievers and those who are evildoers, that they're going to be punished. وَحِرْزًا لِلْأُمِّيِّينَ, that's an addition from the book of the Torah, it's not from the verse. وَحِرْزًا لِلْأُمِّيِّينَ, which means he's a protection, the Prophet of Allah, to the unlettered. Unlettered means the ones who are incapable of writing or reading. So this is a word which is mentioned in the Quran, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, هو الذي بعث في الأميين رسولا منهم يتلو عليهم آياته ويزكيهم يعلمهم الكتاب والحكمة وإن كانوا من قبل لفي ضلال مبين. Surah Al-Jum'ah, verse number 2. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says in this ayat, that is, he who had sent amongst the unlettered, the illiterate, the unlettered or the illiterate, those who cannot read or write, a messenger from amongst themselves, who recites to them his verses, and he's teaching them the book and the wisdom. So Prophet ﷺ also, he said in the hadith, نَحْنُ أُمَّةٌ أُمِّيَّةٌ, we are ummah who are ummiyah. Ummiyah, that means we don't read nor we write. So all the things regarding, for example, the calculation of the moon and all of that, that is, the Prophet ﷺ said, we don't know the hisab. It doesn't mean that we should not know the hisab, we should not learn how to make mathematics. But when the revelation came to us, it came to us to talk to us as unlittered. So for us, the month is either 29 days or is 30 days. So we don't go to as far as, for example, using the astronomy, okay? To the astronomy is no problem, but not to use it in order to determine, like you said, to determine the astronomy, not to use it to determine whether that tomorrow is Eid or tomorrow is the first of Ramadan. So, when the person is born, he's born, well, he reads and writes. he does not, he does, So he's the original when he's born, he's unlettered, he's illiterate until he's been taught. But it doesn't mean that we should be staying unlettered and littered, or illiterate. And as well, me being illiterate, it doesn't mean that you are ignorant. Do you understand that? It's a very important issue. Being illiterate doesn't mean, you know, the Prophet of Allah, he was unlettered and illiterate. Maybe at the end he had started to read and write a bit, but at the beginning, nothing. And this is important to know that he was not a learned person. But he, the Prophet of Allah, was encouraging the companions to learn and read. That is why in the prisoners, or regarding the prisoners and the captives of the Battle of Badr, he said that the person who wants to set himself free, then he has to what? Teach 10 companions to read and write, and then he will set himself free. This one? That's one. That's good. That's better. Now he says, then he describes him, he says, verily, also he says, Anta abdi wa rasuli. That in the Torah it says that you are my slave and you are my messenger. Describing the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam with the best of the names. Abd, the Prophet of Allah is Abd. Abdi means is my slave. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he talked about the night journey and the ascension to the heavens, Subhanalladhi asra bi'abdihi layla min al-masjid al-haram. Glorified be to Allah who had said he had taken his Prophet, which is that Abdi, decided by his slave, in the night journey from Jerusalem, from Mecca to Jerusalem, all the way in one night. So he had mentioned him as Abd, and this is to refute all of those extremists regarding the Prophet of Allah who are saying he's not Abd, he's like an angel. He's not an angel. The Prophet of Allah is a human being. He's a slave. And then he said, Abdi wa Rasuli. And he's a messenger. Of course, Prophet of Allah is a messenger. And this is as well to refute and encounter the extremists from the other side regarding the Prophet of Allah who deny that he's a prophet. So he's an Abd and he's a Rasul. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he had mentioned the Prophet of Allah as to be Abd a number of times in the Quran when he challenged the people regarding the Quran. So he mentioned the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as Abd. وَإِنْ كُنْتُمْ فِي رَيْبٍ مِمَّا نَزَّلْنَا عَلَىٰ عَبْدٍ. And if you are in doubt of what we have revealed to our Abd, our slave, that is Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And when he mentioned him as well regarding the Isra, he mentioned him as in the slave. And we mentioned him as well as a, in the Maqam al-Nubuwa, he mentioned him as a slave, as Abd. And also the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he's been given the choice, Abdul Rasul or Malikul Rasul, he said Abdul Rasul. Do you want to be a king messenger or do you want to be a slave messenger? He said, I want to be what? And Jibreel sallam even pointed for him to what? Humble yourself. So he said, Abdul Rasul. Whereas there is king messengers, like Sulaiman alayhi salam, he's a king and a messenger. But the Prophet of Allah is a slave and a messenger. Slave, then he's not a king. He's not a slave against the free. Slave means he's not a king. So he says, سَمَّيْتُكَ الْمُتَوَكِّلِ. I have named you the Mutawakkil. Mutawakkil is the one who had been appointed, the trusted, basically. The one who had been appointed to take the matter on himself. So if he had guaranteed for you to do something, so I have تَوَكَّلْتُ عَلَيْكَ. I have وَكَّلْتُ أَمْرِي إِلَيْكَ. I have put my matter in your hand. So you are the Mutawakkil. And here you have, as I said, put my matter in your hand. That is, he's the Mutawakkil. And this is also can mean al-mutawakkil is that you are satisfied. You're not asking for more. You are satisfied with the little, and you are patient. Okay, you are patient regarding what you don't like. So this person, you are, if he's a mutawakkil, that means he is suffice with little, as much as possible, as little as possible, and also is patient regarding what he hates. As well, this is the word mutawakkil. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says in the Quran, وَمَا مِن دَابَةٍ إِلَّا رِزْقُهَا عَلَى اللَّهِ. There is not a single animal on the earth except that its provision is upon Allah. Now, I want you to understand the word mutawakkil in the right way, not mutawakkil. Mutawakkil is the one who rely upon Allah and depend upon Allah. Mutawakkil, but he takes his steps in order to provide for himself. So if a person sits in the masjid and does nothing, and he says, I'm mutawakkil upon Allah, and does not get up on his feet and make money for himself, he is not mutawakkil. So when the Imam Ahmed was asked about regarding people in the masjid, and they don't work and they sit, and they would say, until my provision comes to me, Imam Ahmed, he said, this is a man who has ignorance regarding the knowledge. For verily, the Prophet ﷺ, he said, وَجُعِلَ رِزْقِي تَحْتَ ظِلْيُونِ. Allah made my provision under the shade of my spear. That means I have to do something in order to gain my provision. So, if you are making the right tawakkul upon Allah, then Allah will give you the provision, just like the way He gives the bird, which goes in the morning, empty stomach, and then goes, and then comes back with food. Now that bird, all he had to do is just to fly. He didn't go, for example, put his CV with another bird in order to work together and get money and come back. No. All he had to do is just to fly in the morning, and then Allah gave him the provision and he went back. That's called work. And that's called rizq. So if you do the same thing, you get up on your feet and you go to work, Allah will provide you. But to sit at home or sit in the masjid doing nothing, that's not right. I'm asking the brothers to go and tell the kids, either we're going to stop the class or stop the kids. Or these kids has to stop. And I'm really warning because they're really loud. I'm not going to go to the class until these kids are stopping. Right. Also, in the description of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and before I go as well further, you know that there is people of Ahlul Sufa, where there were 400 companions who had no work, no job. And they used to go to the place next to the masjid of the Prophet of Allah. But they never sat down. They used to go in the morning, collect some wood, because they don't have work except for that very sort of, you know, little work. They bring the wood and then they sell it. But that is not going to be enough to bring them a house. So they were homeless. From them is Uqba ibn Abi Amr radiallahu anhu. Uqba ibn Amr radiallahu anhu. Now, those companions, the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he used to prompt the other companions who were rich to go and give sadaqah and zakah for them. One day the Prophet of Allah, he goes to those companions in the Sufa, and he said to them, Ayyukum, who's amongst you, wants to go to Buthan or Al-Aqiq, one of these two valleys which are known to be markets. And they are markets for some things which are precious. Something that the Ahl al-Sufa can afford. You know, you're talking about, like, for example, an auction for example, Lamborghinis and Mercedes and Mercs and Porsches. The poor people will not go there, will they? So he said, who amongst you wants to go to such and such market, that is Buthan or Al-Aqib, in the morning, come back with a camel, she camel, Kaw Mawain, Zahrawain, camels which are specific color, with two humps, like a double carburetor, turbo, two humps, without any sin, without any, as well, severing your kinship relationship. Because usually is the case, if you want to be a super prophet, you have to do cunning, basically, and haram, and might as well, in the expense of your relationship. Okay, you dump your brother in order for a super, okay, sort of prophet. So they said, Messenger of Allah, you know, every morning you go and bring a prophet, which is two she camels or two humps. Well, everybody wants that. Who wants to say no? You're talking to the most poorest people. He said, then one of you could go in the morning to the masjid and recite two verses better for him than two she camels. Recite three verses better than three she camels. Recite four verses and so on and so forth. If I said this, Well, somebody said that to me. And this time, we say to him, okay. Get on with it. Two verses, three verses. Because we don't have the iman. We want the camels, we don't want the verses. True or not? What the camels are? But these companions, they had this iman in their hearts. So he's now, when he goes, he's got the hadith of the Prophet of Allah in his mind. I'm doing two verses, I'm getting two she camel with two humps. Even he can't see it, but he's like seeing it. He can't see it with the eyes of his head, but he could see it with the eyes of his heart. He's there. Allahu Akbar. So that's two she camels. So when I say this to you, and you say, and I read this, it should land on our heart. The same thing that when I come to the masjid, recite two verses, I like getting two mercs or two cars. Double carburetor. Even better. Huh? So, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is telling the companions to go and work. Qal also, laysa bifadhin wala ghaliyu. He is not to be fadh wala ghaliyu. Not to be harsh or coarse. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala described the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he says, فَبِمَا رَحْمَةٍ مِّنَ اللَّهِ لِنْتَ لَهُمْ. That is from the mercy of Allah that you being kind or gentle with them. وَلَوْ كُنْتَ فَضَّاً غَنِيدَ الْقَلْمِ. And if you were to be harsh against them, لَنْفَضُّ مِنْ حَوْلِكَ. These companions would leave you on your own. And this is in Surah Al-Imran, verse 159. So, the person who is harsh, his words are harsh, is no good. Is not right. The person who is nice and gentle with his word, he is the good. So all the time, be gentle with the people who listen to you. So, al-ghilla dhid al-riqqa. To be harsh is the opposite of being gentle. Be gentle. Rafiqa. So, a person, when he is as well talking to the people regarding their bid'ahs, he has to be gentle in the way to address them, not in the way that to make them to hate the religion because of his harshness. So talk to the people in a gentle way. And it's very important. So, also, Allah in another verse, He says about the Prophet of Allah to go and be against the kuffar, وَغْلُظْ عَلَيْهِمْ, and be harsh towards them. That is, be harsh in this sense, that is, harshness in the moment that you need to be harsh is called gentleness. Do you understand what I'm saying? So when you are harsh to someone who you need to be harsh, then it's called gentleness. And I'll give you an example. Prophet ﷺ, he hears a companion saying to him, "Ma sha Allahu wa shikta ya Rasulullah." If Allah wills, and you will, O Messenger of Allah. Now I'm pretty sure that the companion, he doesn't mean to make the Prophet of Allah equal to Allah. No way. He's already had left the idol worshipping. But he had made a mistake in his words. He said, "Ma sha Allahu wa shi'ta. If Allah wills, and you will, Messenger of Allah." So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, "Aja'altani lillahi nidda." Are you making me equal to Allah? A rival with Allah? Qul ma sha Allahu wahdahu. Say, if Allah wills on his own. Now, regardless how good and gentle you're going to say this word, it's not going to come out like this. أَجَعَلْتَنِي لِلَّهِ نِدَّا. It doesn't work like that. It has to be أَجَعَلْتَنِي لِلَّهِ نِدَّا. So this is harshness, but harshness in this moment, it is what? Gentleness. Because sometimes you need to be firm and in your answer, and need to be as well with your face, represents that you are not pleased with what is being taken place, in order to make sure that your message is passed on to that person, otherwise you are deceiving him. Allahu musta'an. This is from the negative things regarding the jama'ah after the jama'ah. The person is reading loud and I can't really talk, and I can't really even teach. Now, so also the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, وَلَا صَخَّابٌ فِي الْأَسْوَاقِ. And he is not a loud person like in the market. Have you been to the fish market? How people they shout? The Prophet of Allah was not like this. وَلَا صَخَّابٌ فِي الْأَسْوَاقَ. Also, Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, description in the Torah, وَلَا يَدْفَعُ السَّيِّئَةَ بِالسَّيِّئَةَ. And he does not push the evil by doing the evil. But actually, if somebody to him evil, he will push it away with
kindness.
قال ولكن يعفو ويغفر. But he pardons and he tolerates. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, ادفع بالتي هي أحسن. ادفع, push away with the best, not with the evil. فإذا الذي بينك وبينه عداوة كأنه ولي حميم. So ادفع بالتي هي أحسن السيئة نحن أعلم بما يصف سورة المؤمنون verse 96. So, Prophet of Allah, in his seerah and biography, we find lots of incidents where the Prophet of Allah, he had tolerated, and his tolerance resulted into that the person would embrace Islam. Or he would call everybody to embrace Islam. On the way back from Ghazwat al-Mughaysir, Bani al-Mustaliq, Prophet of Allah, with the army, they camped. Prophet of Allah goes to a tree, and he shades himself in the tree, and he puts his sword on the tree. So, this man, while the Prophet of Allah is asleep, he takes the sword. Shows you the Prophet of Allah asleep, and he was not aware. And he holds a sword and he puts it on top of the Prophet of Allah and is about to kill him. So he says to him, when the Prophet of Allah walk, he saw him, who is gonna stop me from killing you? So the Prophet said, Allah, with confidence. When he said, Allah, straight away the sword shook and fell in the hands of the Prophet ﷺ. So now the Prophet of Allah is on top of that man. Who's going to protect you from me? So the man, he said, if you want to kill me, get an easy kill. Huh? Get an easy kill. So the Prophet ﷺ, he pardons him. Allahu Akbar. This pardoning of him, because the man, he said, if you let me go, I promise you, I'm not going to go and fight you, nor I'm going to ally myself with other people who are going to fight you. But this man, later on, he goes to his people, and he told them what happened. He himself embraces Islam. The whole tribe of that person embraces Islam. Thumama ibn Athal, the chief of Al-Yamama, from people of Najd, when the companions were sent by the Prophet of Allah towards Najd, they captured this man. And he's the chief of the Imam, and he was a disbeliever. They got him, and they put him in the masjid of the Prophet of Allah in Medina, and they tied him up. Prophet of Allah, he comes to him on the first day. Ha Thumama, what have you got? He said, well, if you're going to kill someone, you're going to kill someone who's got blood. That means there are people after him. They will ask for the blood. I mean, you're going to kill someone from your people. And if you're going to pardon, you're going to pardon on someone who will never forget your favor. And if you want money, I will give you whatever you wish. Prophet Allah left him. Following day, still tied up. Ha, Thumama, what do you want? What do you want to say? Have you got anything to say? He said the same thing. If you want to kill, you're going to kill someone who has got people behind him. You're going to ask for the blood. If you're going to pardon, you're going to pardon on someone, he will never forget your favor. And if you want to ask for money, then ask whatever you want and you'll be given. Third day, same thing. He says the same answer. Fourth day, Prophet of Allah, ha, Thumama, what do you have? He said the same thing. So the Prophet of Allah told the companions, Atliqu Thumama, let him go. So when they let him go, he goes outside, he bathes himself, makes wudu, and comes inside the masjid, and he said, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah. Why? Because of the tolerance. He did not push the evil with the evil. He is the chief of Al-Yamam. He said, Ashhadu an la ilaha. Now he was in the masjid for 3 days. He must have heard the recitation of the Quran. He must have heard the salah of the Prophet of Allah. Because Jubayr ibn Mut'im radiallahu anhu, when he came to negotiate regarding the captives of the Battle of Badr on behalf of the people of Quraysh, and he was a kafir at that time, he said, I went to the masjid and I'm now negotiating with the Prophet of Allah, what are we going to do? How can we, you know, swap the captives of the men, take our captives, pay money, ransom them? So I was there. And it was the time for Salatul Maghrib. He doesn't know Maghrib from Asr from Isha. He was not a Muslim. It was time for the Salah, but it was Salatul Maghrib. Prophet of Allah recites Surah Al-Tur. أَمْ خُلِقُوا مِنْ غَيْرِ شَيْءٍ أَمْ هُمُ الْخَالِقُونَ أَمْ خَلَقُوا السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put that iman in the heart of Jubayr. He said, فَكَادَ قَلْبِي أَنْ يَطِيرُ. My heart almost flew out of my body. Because of the what? Of the recitation of Surah Al-Tur. So this person from the words of the Quran, he embraces Islam. He said, this was the first brink, the first spark of Iman and Deen gone into my heart. Now, same thing here with this man, Thumam ibn Wazal. He must have been listening to the Quran. Then he embraced Islam and then he said to the Prophet, Verily, Prophet of Allah, your face was the most hated face to myself. And now it is the most beloved face to myself. Wallahi, your religion was the most hated religion to myself. Now is your religion the best religion, the most dearest religion to my heart. Wallahi, your land was the most hated land for myself, which is the Medina. Now your land is the most beloved and dearest land to my heart. O Messenger of Allah, I want to go to Umrah. So he gave him a glad tidings, go to do Umrah. They went to do Umrah. The people of Quraysh are in control in Mecca. They said, we heard about this chief of Yamama, racist land. They said to him, Sabaut, that means kafart, you disbelieved now? He said, no, I didn't sabaut, I'm aslant. I believed. You are the disbeliever. By Allah, I will not make any single piece of grain, which is for the wheat, to be exported to you until the Prophet of Allah gives permission for that. You know that Mecca used to depend upon people of Najd for wheat. So he said, Wallahi, not a single piece of grain will go from Yamama to you until the Prophet of Allah he gives the permission for it. So what is the cause of all of that? Kana ya'fu wa yaghfir. He used to be tolerant and he used to be what? Forgiving. So idfa' billati hi ahsan. Idfa' billati hi ahsan as-sayyi'a. Nahnu a'lamu bima yasifun. Also, he says, وَلَنْ يَقْبِضَهُ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى. That is, Abdullah ibn Abbas, he says, in the Torah, he says, Allah will not pass death upon him. He will not take him. حَتَّى يُقِيمَ بِهِ الْمِلَّةَ الْعَوْجَى. Until he straighten with him the crooked nation. Who is the crooked nation? A crooked nation, that means the disbelieving nation. The ones who are worshipping idols. Some of the scholars, they said, the nations of the Arabs. Because the Arabs, which the ones who are on the religion of Ibrahim alayhi salam, they're supposed to be monotheistic. But what happened? They became polytheistic. They're worshipping the idols. So they're not straight nation. They are what? Crooked now. So the Prophet of Allah came to what? To make it back straight as it was. So also he says, قَلْ وَيَفْتَحُ بِهَا أَعْيُنًا عُمْيًا. And also that is to open eyes which are closed, وَأَذَانًا صُمًّا, and deaf ears. These are metaphorical speech. That means to make the haq to reach these people. And وَقُلُوبًا غُلْفًا, and hearts which are covered with the rust and the ran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he sent the Prophet in order as well to remove that ran, to remove that barrier between the heart and between receiving the haq. So we understand from this hadith, that is, Al-inbisatu ila nas. This is the whole chapter, is to be cheerful towards the people. What was the cheerfulness here? Of the Prophet of Allah, that is in the description of the Torah, kana ya'fu wa yaghfir. Is to tolerate, that's being cheerful to the people. Kana ya'fu wa yaghfir. And also we understand from this hadith, that if the imam, or the khalifa, or the king, or the prince, came to the market, it is not going to demean him. Some people say, why is he coming to the market? Why is he? No. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he used to go to the market because he says, وَلَا صَخَّابٌ فِي الْأَسْوَاقِ. And he's not to be with a sound, which is a loud sound in the market. But he used to go to the market. So for the leader to go to the market, it does not belittle him. So lots of things that we could, alhamdulillah, benefited from this. But this is coming under the chapter of being cheerful. And the Prophet of Allah be described by the Torah to be a person who tolerates and a person who forgives, which is part of cheerfulness. 248, عن معاوية رضي الله عنه قال سمعت من النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم كلاما نفعني الله به سمعته يقول سمعت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول إنك إذا اتبعت الريبة أو الريبة في الناس أفسدتهم. That is, I think I need to, just in a second. Two hundred forty-six, so we have done it. So 247 is being dealt with. That is why we go into 248. The translation of the hadith, basically, that Muawiyah ibn Abi Sufyan radiallahu anhu, he said, I heard the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam saying words which Allah benefited me from these words. I've heard him saying, that is, if you openly show your suspicions of people, you will corrupt them. So if you show and openly show your suspicion into the people, then you have corrupted them. And that is why, therefore, I don't show my suspicions of people openly, so I will not corrupt them. Now this is, first of all, the Prophet of Allah directing his words to Muawiyah. It's an indication that Muawiyah will become a leader. That's an important issue. Because it's Prophet of Allah directing his word to Muawiyah, meaning Muawiyah is going to be a leader. Because he says that if you're going to be following your suspicion into the people and show that you are suspicious about people, then you will corrupt them. So that means don't do that when you become a leader. So that's a great benefit that we benefit from this. Here he says that if you follow the suspicion into the people, that means you have openly, clearly you said to them that I've got bad opinion about you. I don't think good about you. Then actually you will make them to do what you are afraid for them to do. That means what you are suspicious of them going to be doing. So if you had bad opinion in them to doing something and openly had shown that to them, you have corrupted them because you're going to push them to do what you are suspicious of them doing. So if you said about a person, I'm suspicious that you are a thief, he might start stealing from you because you're going to corrupt him. Do you understand that? So don't follow your suspicion openly into the people because that will corrupt them. What is the link between this hadith and the chapter title being cheerful toward, or cheerfulness towards the people? It's actually because you don't follow the suspicion opening the people. That's being cheerful to the people. So if a person did something which you are suspicion about it, keep your suspicion, what? To yourself. Don't show it to him. Because that will not be cheerful to him. That would as well reflect negatively in making this person doing what you are suspicious of him doing. And also it tells us that you're not to spy on other people. So spying on other people is not really good. To follow your suspicion and by starting spying on the people is not good. Because that would lead to extra things. To lots of, and also to follow their awrat. Yeah. Ya man amantum bilisanikum. That means Prophet of Allah, Ya ma'ashara man amana bilisanikum. It's talking to us. The one who had got belief in his tongue. وَلَمَّا يَدْخُلِ الْإِيمَانُ فِي قُلُوبِكُمْ. And yet the iman to enter your heart. لَا تَتَّبِعُوا عَوْرَاتِ الْمُسْلِمِينَ. Don't follow the awrat, the privacy. Don't penetrate the privacy of the Muslims. فَإِنَّهُ مَا تَتَّبَّعَ عَوْرَةَ أَخِي تَتَّبَّعَ اللَّهُ عَوْرَتَهُ. He who going to penetrate the privacy of other brothers and start spying on them, Allah will follow his privacy as well and expose it. حَتَّى يَضَّحُهُ فِي جَوْفِي وَلَوْ فِي جَوْفِي بَيْتِ. And until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make a scandal of him even in the middle of his house. So you have to be tolerant. خُذِ الْعَفْوِ وَأْمُرْ بِالْعُرْفِ وَأَعْرِضْ عَنِ الْجَاهِلِ. That's what we have learned from the hadith which is previously. So you have to keep away from anything that make the people, you know, come to their religion. And this is from the way of stopping the people coming to their religion, is to have suspicion about them and openly manifest that suspicion into your words, into your smiles, into the way that you talk to them. So you have to have husnul dhan and prohibition of tajassus as well, which is meaning to have to be a spy onto your brothers. At-tabassum, chapter 125, which means At-tabassum, to be smiling, or to smile. So smiling. عن جرير قال ما رآني رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم منذ أسلمت إلا تبسم في وجهي. Jarir, he said, since the time I became a Muslim, the Messenger of Allah, may Allah bless him and grant him peace, never saw me without smiling at me. Never saw me without smiling at me. So here, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he makes a smile. What is the difference of smile and a laugh? And qahqaha. We have in Arabic tabassum, ضحك أم قهقه. If you laugh with a noise that is audible to the person who is far, it's called قهقه. If you laugh with a noise which is only audible to yourself and the people close to you, that's called ضحك, laughter. If you smile without any noise, that is called what? Smile. تبسم. These are the three words in Arabic. So here he said, ما رآني رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم منذ أسلمت إلا تبسم في وجهي. That means that always the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he would smile to my face since the day I embraced Islam. And because the Prophet of Allah said, تبسمك في وجه أخيك صدقة. If you smile in the face of your brother, it is considered to be a sadaqah, a charity. Even without paying money, it's a charity. It shows us as well the manners of the Prophet of Allah, the humbleness of the Prophet of Allah, the cheerfulness of the Prophet of Allah, the very closeness of the Prophet of Allah to the companions and to the people. And that is why he penetrated the hearts so quickly. And with his da'wah, he had made lots of thousands of people in no time to embrace Islam and to follow him. And remember, the Arabs got this pride into them. If they did not have, or they did not sense any sort of wisdom into the da'wah of the Prophet of Allah or into Islam, they will fight it to the last drop of blood. The Arabs, they will not let go. And that is why when you have a conflict between Arabs or a fight, you know, it's not like, you know, the fact that these days takes 1 day, 2 days, 1 month, 2 months, 1 year, 2 years.
No.
Minimum 40 years. 40 years, 100 years. Even though that it is a fight between an inferior tribe and a big tribe. Because of the pride, those little group, they will never surrender the last drop of the blood of that person. Even if there's nobody left, it doesn't matter. At least as well, they didn't really humiliate themselves. And that's how it was. They are. So any person who claimed that the Prophet of Allah had spread Islam through the sword, he said, he don't know the Arabs. He don't know the Arabs. The Arabs, if they did not sense any sort of common sense into that da'wah, if this da'wah is against their fitrah, they'll fight it to the last drop of their blood. They will not let go. And I'm just telling you that it has to be the words of Allah that penetrated the hearts of the people. And the kibr and the pride was in the Arabs, because of their ignorance. But when Islam came, it turned that arrogance into that humbleness, that pride into that submissiveness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. No arrogance, only humbleness. But before, it was all of it, if you talk about the poetry. The poetry is all of it about being pride. And how much we have, and how big we are, and how noble we are. And they boast all the time. And they talk about the sword, they've got the sword. You know, the sword has got 500 names in ours. 500 names for the sword. 500 names? Subhanallah. And for the lion, oh, so many names, lion. And they call the lion, and what the lion does, subhanallah. So these people, they used to have pride. So, humbleness. The Prophet ﷺ, he was humble. And the Prophet ﷺ used to smile. And Jarir ibn Abdullah, radiallahu, Jarir, radiallahu anhu, when he embraced Islam, he, the Prophet of Allah, used to smile to him. Also, the Prophet ﷺ, he said, يَدْخُلُ مِنْ هَذَا الْبَابِ رَجُلٌ مِنْ خَيْرِ بِيَمَنِ على وجهه مسحة ملك جرير. He entered. Now this is to show us how جرير رضي الله عنه as well being described by the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. He said 250 the hadith, which is the same. That is, the Messenger of Allah said, when people see, the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said, a man from the best of ذو يمن will enter by the door, or this door, whose face has been touched by an angel. Translation is not really touched by an angel. That means he's got the touch of an angel. That means his face looking like an angel. He's got an angel face. This is being said to a person whose face is glowing of iman. It's got like, you know, it's a phrase by which you praise someone with. He's got mashatu malak. This is like the look of an angel. What happened is that Jarir radiallahu anhu said, when I came to the Medina, I had put my camel down I parked it and knelt down. And then I had put my hulla, my garment. And then I came inside and the people started looking at me. So I said to them, did the Prophet of Allah mention me? They said, yes, with a good mentioning. He said, verily, verily, they will be coming from this door, from this gate, a person who is from the best of Dhul Yemen. I mean, he's from Yemen. And he's got the touch of an angel in his face. And you came. And that's a very, you could say, good statement in the favor of Jarir radiallahu anhu wa radha. Here being cheerful as well to the Prophet ﷺ, being cheerful to him, because every time he sees Jarir, he would be smiling to him. Now, coming to the last hadith that we're going to handle in this topic, 251. No, I'll leave that one. I'll leave that one, inshallah. I'm going to our book.